like I say, shout out to all my brothers and sisters out there in social media land. This is indeed a great day to be alive. This is the day that the Most High Heavenly Father have made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Hope everybody out there having a good day on this morning. We're going to pick up a video series on wisdom. So for all the brothers and sisters out there that got a little opportunity of leisure to chime in, shouts out to you, Sister Styles, Asin Nazarite, give me Yahoo, my big brother, shouts out to you, Mahalia, Yahshua, all praises, all honor, all glory to the Most High Heavenly Father. Once again, this is indeed a great day to be alive. It's a day that I'm up, ready to rejoice. I'm glad in it. I'm on the phone. I'm about to go out here in this world. I'm about to find somebody that needs some help. Somebody that needs to be picked up. Somebody that needs to be encouraged. I'm about to go out there and find somebody that needs some forgiveness, some mercy, some grace, some compassion. Ready to go out there and tell some of my brothers, get back up. You can do it. You can do it. So we're dealing with wisdom. We're dealing with wisdom. And there was a scripture contained in the book of Proverbs that says, he who would be wise, let him become a fool that he may be wise. Shouts out to you, Sister Lisa. Shouts out to you, Judah. Shouts out to you, Alicia. Shouts out to you, Yoshi. Yahoo, I know you out there. Demonstrate. Shouts out to my nephew, DeAndre. All praises, all honor, all glory. DeAndre, drop me a line, man. Let me know what you're doing and where you at today, man. I'll pull up on you. I need to come over there and support you. And like I said, we want to get some of those garments online. Boy, you spitting out some flame with that clothing line that you started up. So all praise, all honor, all glory. When we're talking about dealing with wisdom, wisdom is non-transferable. The only way you're going to get it, you got to be seeking it. You got to be searching it out for yourself. Sister Lisa, I want to encourage you. That was a beautiful post that you put on there before you left for California. Dealing with how you shutting down on anything that ain't right. Ain't no man coming in, and that's how it's supposed to be. You the one got to remember, you fearfully and marvelously made, created in the Most High's image, and you don't settle for nothing less than that. The man that find you, to come, he got to ride in on a white horse. That mean that he owns something. He got his own stuff. He got his own credit. When he pick your handkerchief up, that means that he's ready to assume the full responsibility. Ain't nobody just going to walk into your life. Ain't none of those sisters. All of you sisters, this the mind frame you got to have. If you're going to be able to help our brothers, if you're going to be able to raise us up, this is the type of mindset that you're going to have. I ain't settling for no anything. You know what I mean? The Most I created me to be a help me, to be some assistance. So you got to be ready to receive this good thing. And if you ain't ready for it, then I'm gonna leave you by yourself until I deem that you're ready. So all praise, all honor, all glory to the Most High Heavenly Father. On this particular day, we're going to start this off with an intro song while I pull up a couple of scriptures. We're going to still be dealing with the books of wisdom. All of us should want to be wise. We put a post on Facebook the other day. We said, which would you rather have? Would you rather have money? Would you rather have favor of men? Or would you rather have wisdom? And the vast majority of our people said that they'd rather have money. But baby, let me tell you something. The old folks had a saying. They used to say, a fool and his money will soon depart. There's many brothers and sisters that get money in their hand and up one minute and broke the next. Win the lottery and broke the next minute. Next time you turn around, look at Rodney King. Got all them millions and died broke. So the money, that's not it. You're chasing after the wrong thing. Because if you get money and you don't have the wisdom to understand how the money is supposed to be used, then guess what? It's going to bring you to shame. So we're going to open this up with an intro song. Because this is what I'm feeling today. I know somebody else might be feeling that. This song is titled Alive. It's coming to you by one of our own. My young cousin, Cut Calhoun, and we're going to drop this on here, and I hope everybody enjoys it. Yep, that's right, soon depart, give me Yahoo. Let's go for it.
If you haven't booked travel to Hopper,
let's get through the commercial. If anybody out there feel alive this morning, put a 7 up in there. I'm fired up, I'm amped already. The day ain't even got started yet. Me and the righteous man cared for the father's beast. Me and the dog, we've been out walking through the neighborhood, getting a breath of fresh air, letting the glorious sun shine on our face, breathing in the Most High's wonderful air. We give all praise, all honor, all glory to the Most High Heavenly Father. We thank him for our earthly mother, by which all things in this earth grow, where we have our sustenance. We give praise, honor, and all glory to the angels of the earthly mother, angel of the power of the sun that causes things to be burned out of us that are not right. Angel over the power of the air that causes oxygen to be pumped in and out of our lungs. Angel over the power of the water that cleanses us both within and without. We give honor and glory to the Most High Heavenly Father for those things already. So let's go forth with the music.
Cut. They said we were never gonna make it.
Anybody ever said you wasn't gonna make it? Anybody ever said you was dead? Anybody ever said your life was finished? It was washed up? Well, I come to serve notice on you today that it ain't. It's just the beginning. He that would be wise must be a fool first. That means it got to be some bad choices made.
Down the empires, they claim to take over the entire industries. Thank God for the hate, y'all niggas did on me because
I feel so alive, like I'm barely breathing.
Shouts out to you, Adrian Hicks. Anybody out there feel alive today? If you feel alive today, put a 7 up in there.
Looking back on my life, somewhat reminiscing on my career, we got to get back on our track. How what?
These record labels will do you if you keep eating what they be to you. Once your stomach's up, then you're cool. Call that food with all of you chewing.
Now that's hard to swallow. Hey, won't even let you wash it down with a water bottle.
Can't it be a better way for you to get it back? Cause you was better off than starving. Made the bed that you lied in, but your lies tied in for 9 years. And you realize that this whole ride is one big lie that you signed in.
If people ever look at your life, said you wasn't gonna make it, said you wasn't gonna mount to nothing, said you was in a situation that you wasn't never gonna get out of, put a 7 up in there. If the Most High reached down in a gutter, raised you up, then started walking with you by the crooked places, gave you wisdom to know how to get back.
Could write a book with all of this content about do's and don'ts in this shaky business. We fall victim to the small print. Signing your life away,
so you need to make sure that you got a
lawyer handy to spot the grave.
Henry has to make sure
your deal's solid, your points is on point, you're publishing it all close to you with an exit clause. If they still provide what you need, then it's not the best to move.
Just follow me, this guy labels reaching out to undereducated and seasoned. If you believe them, you'll be the reason you hold the shelf in your promise. Free from all
you better. You better make it count.
This day and age, cause time's up and essence.
Get you a base amount.
Being wise and make smart investments.
And use all your leverage. Don't give a John Hancock in lessons. Work your ride and bless it. I'm living proof so I can't contest it.
It's a long, hard road sometimes, baby. But ain't nothing like eating a steak in your enemy's face. Ain't nothing like it, baby. Ain't nothing like it. To any brother or sister out there, failed marriage, divorce, bumped off children, drug habit, alcoholism, lost everything, housing crash, lost a job, market crash, whatever it is, put your faith and trust in the Most High. Chase after that wisdom. Chase after that wisdom. Chase after that wisdom. He that would be wise, let him become a fool that he may be wise. If you made some bad choices, baby, you got to be able to embrace those bad choices that you have made and said, hey, that was a bad choice, but I'm chasing after wisdom. All I got to do is make a set of better choices, and they're going to produce a set of better results, and that's going to make my life begin to shine. And that causes you to feel alive. This is indeed a great day to be alive. Somebody didn't make it to see this day, but you did. All praises, all honor, all glory to the Most High Heavenly Father. Shouts out to my young king, King Rashard. Shouts out to all of you brothers and sisters. We're going to pick this video up. Dealing with wisdom, chasing after wisdom. Length of days is in her right hand. Riches and honor is in her left hand. Don't chase after just to live a long life. Eating right. I don't smoke. I don't drink. I don't do none of that. But if you don't get wisdom, you'll still find yourself making some bad choices, no matter how good you're eating. Because the Bible say that bodily exercise profited little, but godliness, which is wisdom, is of great profit. Don't chase after money. Don't chase after beauty. Both of them are vain. They take wings and they fly away. If brother, if the only reason why you want to chase after a woman is because she's pretty, that beauty is going to grow wings and fly away. Beauty is vain and it's fleeting. You need to chase after a sister that got some wisdom down on you. One that got wisdom and the courage to tell you, hey, baby, I don't think you're making the right decision. Hey, baby, you need to get over a little bit. Hey, baby, why don't you try it this way? You need a woman in your life that can critique you, that can stand in your face when you're out of order without you feeling like, she's disrespecting you. I don't want no yes woman. I don't want my sweetie pie to just be like some little cat that goes and lay down in the corner. Every now and my sweetie pie stand in my face and say, baby, you're dead wrong. I think you need to go back and apologize. You know you could have handled that a little bit better. You ain't treating me like you treat the people on Facebook. Every now and then you need a woman to stand in your face. That critiquing will make you a better man, and that's the reason why God puts her in your life. So all praises, all honor, all glory to the Most High Heavenly Father and His glorious Son. Shouts out to you, Pam, extremely blessed. Anderson, my cousin, we're going to take right off into the video. As we said before, I'm already fired up. I'm already amped up. If somebody looking for a blessing, here it is right here. Let's take off. We're coming out of the 13th chapter of the book of Proverbs. If you desire to see righteousness in your life, if you don't like the way that your life is going, if you don't like the living, then it's time to change the building. And the only thing it takes to change the building is to make a series of different choices other than the ones that we made yesterday. Let's go. First verse of chapter 13 declares, a wise son heareth his father's instruction, but a scorner hears not rebuke. You see, if you're going to be a wise woman or a wise man, first thing you got to do is you got to be able to receive instruction. You got to be able to be critiqued. You got to be able to be chastised, corrected, or rebuked, because those things are directly related to bad decisions making and bad choices that you're making, whereby if you were able to see that it was a bad choice that you was about to make, if you can receive that and make a different choice, you see, that's instruction. That's a wise son or a wise daughter able to accept the instruction. Name the instruction that comes out of Scripture, because the Messiah is the wonderful counselor. He is the wonderful counselor. And when we hear that instruction coming out of the book, if we want to be wise, our wisdom is going to be predicated on whether or not we can receive the instruction. So it says a wise son or a wise daughter, they will hear the instruction of a father, but a scorner hears not rebuke. What is a scorner? A scorner is somebody that think they know it all. A scorner is somebody that's like a mocker that makes fun of what you do. Oh, there she come again. Miss Holier Than Thou. Oh, there's Sister Witherspoon. Oh, there's Reverend Ike. There's Deacon Durong. There's, see, that's a scorner. A scorner is somebody that ain't felt the full wrath of their bad choices yet, and they scorn or mock or make fun of wisdom and instruction when it comes. And you don't want to be that kind of person. If your brother or sister on here and you're chasing after wisdom, you got to understand that correction and rebuke and chastisement is going to be a part of your growth process, because we don't know everything. When the book of Proverbs say he that would be wise must be a fool first before he can be wise, because in the midst of our foolishness that the Most High can see in his instruction of chastisement, rebuke, or correction. And based on whether or not we can receive those things, it's going to be what determines whether or not we get wisdom in that particular area. So how do you tell the difference between whether I've gotten wiser or whether I'm still a fool? You can only tell the difference when you face with the same situation again, based on what choice you make. If I make the same choice that I made the last time, then I'm still a fool. But if I make a different choice other than the choice that I made the last time, that means that I have learned from that bad choice and it has brought me one step closer, and I become a little bit more wiser in that area. So the first thing is we got to be able to receive instruction. How be it, you got the preachers, you got the pastors, you got the camp leaders, you got the Sabbath day teachers, you got all these jokers out front holding the Bible and this and that and the other. But when you come with some correction, some critique, or some chastisement, they want to go to war. They themselves can't receive nothing but want to teach everybody everything. So King Rashard sent me a text yesterday. And he said, you can't make this up. And I said, I know you can't make it up. He said, now check this out. He said, before I go any farther, I'm going to set this right here. And I'm going to demand the answer. What is this? Well, actually, what he was looking at is original ancient Torah text that gave the first five of the first books of the Torah. Well, many of our brothers live by the first five books of the Bible that they classify Torah. But this particular had one extra book. And the extra book that it had in there was the very book that many of the brothers that say that they Torah centered, that say that they walking by Torah, it's one of the books that they reject. But see, when that knowledge come rolling out there later on down the line, now you got to determine what you're going to deal with it. Are you still going to classify it as a rejected book, even though what you maybe see may be far more ancient or far more older than any other resource that you're using now? See, what decision that you make is going to determine whether or not you stay a fool or not. So that first thing is that we got to be able to hear instruction when it comes. Verse 2, a man shall eat good by the fruit of his mouth, but the soul of the transgressor shall eat violence. A man gonna eat good by the fruit of his mouth. You know why? Because the Messiah said it's not that that goes in a mouth that defiles him, but it's what comes out of a man's mouth that defiles him. For everything that comes out of a man or a woman's mouth proceeds from the heart. So a righteous man gonna eat good by the fruit of his mouth, based or because of what's down on the inside of his heart. But a transgressor, he shall eat violence. See, a transgressor is somebody that has no regard for the Father's instruction. And because of that, there is going to be wrath. And wrath is God's anger when it's kindled. And it becomes violence in this world toward one that will not bend the knee or will not heed the instruction. So the thing is that we're going to have to be wise. We're going to have to make a decision. We're going to have to make a determination. Which one of these people that I'm going to be? Both of these people are locked up in one body. It's the twofold nature of a man who has a choice to determine how he's going to live his life. Either he can live his life as a righteous man or he can live his life as a fool. You got to make the choice. He that keepeth his mouth keepeth his life, but he that open wide his lips shall have destruction. Everything don't deserve a response. What this is simply saying is that you're dealing with what James talked about, that the tongue is the smallest member on the body, yet it does the most damage. It can set the whole world on fire, because the tongue, how we use our mouths, is going to be very important. But it says a wise person keeps his mouth and keeps his life. If you're going to be wise, you got to understand that some things I don't even respond to. Some things I ain't even going to pay attention to. Because why am I going to sit there and start talking to you in a way that's going to lead me into an argument where I get heated and now my mouth starts saying things and becoming a destructive force that it shouldn't say? If you're going to be wise, you got to learn how to keep your mouth. Some things don't even need to be spoken on. Some things I hear and ain't got no response. Some things I see and ain't got no response. Because some things you can hear. When you respond, you're going to lose the ability to keep your mouth. And do you know how many people have lost their lives when all they had to do is just be quiet and go on about their business? He who keeps his mouth. James said, that's what the tongue is. It's uncontrollable. Who can control it? Isaiah said, I seen the angel coming and he took coals off the altar and he put those coals on my mouth to purify my mouth. He said, who shall I sin? Oh, sin me. I'm a man of unclean lips and unclean hands, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips and hands. But when that live coal get on your mouth and purify your mouth, you understand that I don't respond to everything. I must be a keeper of what comes out of my mouth, because what comes out of my mouth can't be taken back. And in the hands of the tongue or the mouth is the keys of life and death. But if you're going to be wise, you got to understand how to keep your mouth. James gives an example of what God wants out of us when it comes to us being able to keep our mouth. He said, take the horse for instance. A horse is a wild animal, an unbridled animal. He said, but if I want to get control of the horse, we put bits in the horse's mouth. And a bit is a metal bar that goes from one side of the mouth unto the other side. And then you have the reins that's attached to the bit that you hold. And he said, I pull the horse, he gonna stop because that bit is in his mouth. If I tell him to go that way, he gonna go that way because that bit. And that's what the Most High's word is supposed to do. He said, when I can get the bit of my word in my people's mouth, then my word is going to guide them wherever I want them to go. It's going to tell them when they need to stop or when they need to go. We got to be keepers of our mouth. If you married, you got to be a keeper of your mouth, husband. You can't just say anything to your wife when you get angry. It destroys in those words. Or life and death. Things said out of the mouth would destroy a marriage. If you married, sister, you got to be careful of the things that you allow to come out of your mouth. Things can come out of your mouth that can destroy the man that loves you. In the heated battle or the heated moment of an argument, you got to be careful. But the righteous person is conscious of these things. And they will understand when things are going too far and they'll keep their mouth. They'll understand that soft-spoken words turn away anger and wrath. But harsh words lead to destruction. So the righteous man or a woman, these are things that we have to practice on a daily basis, whether you at your job. You can't let people piss you off to where you start letting things come out of your mouth. You lose control or the ability to control the things that you have to say. You can lose your job. That can bring about death from insubordinates. Even though your supervisor might have been wrong, you can find yourself not being able to bridle your tongue. And then even though they wrong, you the one that lose your job. Because when you can't keep your mouth, it brings forth death. You see? And there are multiplicity of ways in this life that we're living that things can die. They don't just die from the standpoint of physical death. There are many ways. A marriage can die. A job can die. A relationship can die based on how we use our mouth. He said, but he that open wide his lips shall have destruction. And there are many brothers and sisters that are out there like this. And many of us have been like this at one point or another in our life. For those of us that have been like this, you see, we have been fools. And we have come to no wisdom because of our foolishness. And I tell you, it used to be a time when I was young, I was a professional cursor. I was a professional cursor. Every other word out of my mouth was a curse word. And it didn't make no difference. I'd be sitting there cursing and it'd be older people around and everything. And I'm saying, boy, you know your daddy didn't raise you up here like this. Boy, if your mom, your daddy, or your grandma and them heard you out here using this language like this, you know what I'm saying? They probably beat the heck out of you. But that's what I heard them using on a daily basis. So I start moving in some of those same areas. And so many of us, we move in those same areas too. So we have to learn how to change some of those things. Shouts out to you, Gabriel. Yeah, so we want to be able to keep our mouth. We want to have wholesome speech as best as we can. When Proverbs said that it's better for a man to dwell on the corner of a housetop than in a wide open space with an angry and contentious woman, this is what he's talking about. And this is interchangeable. It's better for a woman to dwell in the corner of a housetop than to dwell in a wide open space with an angry and contentious man. Because in this particular hour, because people have lost the ability to keep their words, to keep their tone, you got men out here killing women. You got brothers killing women. And most of the time, like I was having a conversation with my wife the other day, we was looking at a first 48 last night. Well, this man, he done stabbed this woman. He done killed this woman he'd been with for 30 years. But the daughter was talking to the police, and she was telling her how combative her mama was. And that her mama was combative in the streets and all of this. You know, come to find out, this woman, she was so combative, she had no problem fighting. She even had been taken to jail for beating a man with a hammer before. You know what I'm saying? But he done murdered this woman. This is what us not having the ability to use our words lead to. You see, he who opens wide his lips shall have destruction. When you have an unbridled mouth, you can best believe, sister, if you're one of them sisters out there that you got an unbridled mouth, and you know what? And you know, you let anything fly out of your mouth, you talk to a man any kind of way, you're going to be one of them sisters that get their teeth knocked out. Don't y'all go nowhere. It's not the phone. Okay, so all praise to the Most High. Everybody's still here. But anyway, like I said, if you're a combative woman, you see, that's not wisdom. It doesn't mean that you're not right. It just means that when you're operating in wisdom, you understand the repercussion or the possibility of things escalating, going someplace that makes a situation far worse. Sometimes, like when you're a sister and you just silent, when you know you have every right to lash out and you just be silent, you leave place for the Spirit of the Most High to now deal with that man. You know what I mean? You see, because, you know, so it said he that open wide his lips gonna have destruction. Ain't nobody can change the word. The word gonna carry itself out. It's gonna do what it say it do. And if it tell you that when we operate like this, something bad gonna happen, you can best believe something bad is on the way. Shouts out to you, who is that? Naziel. Shouts out to you, Christopher. Shouts out to you, Thomas Pollard. All praise, all honor, all glory for all the brothers and sisters that's chiming in that have opportunity of leisure. So let's go. Verse 4, the soul of the sluggard desireth and have nothing, but the soul of the diligent shall be made fat. Man, you remember we went over the sluggard, how the Bible says, go to the ant, thou sluggard, and consider her ways and be wise. God that made the wisest creature on the planet to be the bug that you swat off of you or that you just kill for no reason. He said, go to the ant, thou sluggard, consider her ways and be wise. And then he tell you what her ways was like. She gets up, she don't have no guide, she don't have no overseer, yet she provide and gather her meat, she provide her meat in the summer and gather her food in the time of harvest. He said, go. He said, the sluggard, the soul of the sluggard desireth but have nothing. You know what? The soul of the sluggard is a lazy man. He's too lazy to get up. He's too lazy to get up and go do anything. So he desires to have what he sees other people getting up like the ant at 7, 6 o'clock in the morning, going to work so that they can provide food, so that they can provide a home, so that they can have the things that they need to sustain them in their house. He watches those people have a nice car, have a nice job. He watches those people have good credit and all of that. He looks at those people as though what they got, somebody just gave them. And he desires to have it. But he himself, he won't get up and look for a job. He wants to be up all night and then sleep all day. And then only thing he do is desire. These are the brothers that you can find climbing through somebody's window while they at home taking a chance on their life. These are the brothers out there that you can find ready to rob somebody who been working for their things. These are the brothers out there that you can find, like Proverbs said, that they laying in and waiting for blood so that they can kill somebody else for what they got. The sluggard desires to have, but he has nothing, because you don't understand the only way you're going to have anything is if you start operating like the ant. And sisters, don't you ever allow no man, if you hooked up with a man like that, you go to the Most High and you pray for an exit to get away from that joker. Soul of the sluggard, he desires, but he have nothing. You know somebody, if you know somebody in your life, if you know somebody in your life that have a desire to have what you have a desire to do what you do, to go where you go, but they can't. If you know somebody like that, put a 7 up in there. Because I know brothers like that. You got them in your own family. They desire to have what you have. I tell my children, I tell my son, hey, baby, just because you my son, just because you my daughter, that don't entitle you to what I work for in my life. If you're going to have anything in your life, you're going to have to be the one to go out there and get it just like I did. You got a mother and a father in this earth. I came up, I didn't have no mother, no father, no aunties, no uncles. Only thing it was me, the sisters and brothers and the cousins. And they was going to show you how to get it done. But ultimately, you was going to be the one to make it happen. And if you didn't have nothing going on in your life, that was your fault. You couldn't expect nobody else to do nothing for you. So all praises to the Most High Heavenly Father and His glorious Son for that. The sluggard, he desires to have, but he don't have nothing because he's too lazy to go out there and get it. He ain't got no aspirations, ain't got no desire, ain't got no dreams, no visions, nothing that's in him that drives him. You ain't getting nothing. It says, but the soul of the diligent is made fat. To be diligent is like a clock that's steadily ticking. You know, a clock got all of those different working things in it. And every last one of them is moving simultaneously together to keep a thing connected. That's what it means to be diligent. To be diligent is like one drop of water that don't drop no faster, no slower. But one drop of water, if it's consistent and do not stop, can cause a rock to break in half. And that's the hand of the diligent. When we are diligent about what we're doing, when we're diligent about our learning, diligent about our applications of these things to our life, diligent about working, diligent about taking care of things, when we're diligent and wake up every day with something to do and a goal in mind, and we hammering away at it, our soul will be made fat. We ain't going to have a want for nothing. We're not going to want for anything. So we get to pick and choose which end of the spectrum that we want to be on. It says, the righteous keepeth him that is upright in the way, but wickedness overthrow the sinner. You see, am I my brother's keeper? Yes, I am my brother's keeper. Well, who is my brother? My brother is the man that's doing righteousness, because the book of wisdom tells me, know to who you're going to do your good to. You can't be a keeper of everybody. Everybody ain't trying to do the right thing. You can't keep rescuing people that got a made up mind that they ain't ready to do righteous. He said, but the righteous keepeth him that is upright. Him that is upright that stumbles, he got a righteous brother that'll catch him when he falls, or pick him up, dust him off, and send him back on his way. That's what we are to each other. Shout out to you, Frank Dean. That's what we are to each other. The righteous man keeps the upright. Let me put a precept on top of this. Chapter 7 of the book of Ecclesiasticus says, when thou wilt do good, know to whom thou doest it. So shall thou be thanked for thy benefits. Verse 2, do good to the godly man, and thou shalt find a reward. And if not from him, then you will find it from the Most High. But there can come no good to him that is always occupied in evil, nor to him that gives no alms. You see that? So when this book here is telling you that the righteous man is kept by the upright, the upright man is kept by the righteous, it means that the righteous man understands who he's supposed to do his good to. He's not supposed to do his good to the ungodly. He's not supposed to do his good to nobody that don't give alms. To give alms is the alms or good deeds. He's not supposed to give his help, righteous help, to somebody that won't help nobody else. And I know that many of us, brothers and sisters, we got family members, we got children, we got loved ones, but they're not operating righteous. And every time you turn around, they want you to come and rescue them. They use you like the emergency escape plan. Well, I know he's going to come and rescue me. I know she's going to come and rescue me. But let me tell you something. If you're going to have wisdom, you got to draw a line of distinction between the upright and the ungodly. And God says, help the upright, but do not help the ungodly. You'll clog your own flow up. There he is that make, verse 7, there he is that make himself rich, yet have nothing. There he is that make himself poor, yet have great riches. You remember the post the other day. Which would you rather have? Would you rather have money, favor of men, or wisdom? Most people said money. That's the people that this book talking about. There is a man or a woman in this world that exerts all of their energy into becoming rich, yet they have nothing. That means that they're impoverished on the inside. They don't have no spiritual riches at all. No spiritual wisdom, no spiritual understanding. The only thing they have put all their energy is heaping up money. He said, but there is another one that makes himself poor, yet has great riches. You can be rich in two ways in this world. You can be rich in this world according to the understanding of the world by physical things, or you can be rich in spiritual things in the eyes of the Most High. And this is drawing a line of distinction between the two. And one of them is a wise man and one of them is a fool. Because the one that's heaping up riches in this world, understand that he's completely impoverished in the eyes of God. The one that has not put made money, the emphasis on everything, he is the one. The one that puts his energy in chasing after wisdom will be classified as the one that is rich in the eyes of God, even though people look at him as though he don't have much. You see, I'm in Kansas City, Missouri with my brothers. I don't have, man, please. Now I come up, I pull up and park my car. And then I got my brothers, they come up parking their cars. They parking convertibles, you know what I'm saying? Beating on 26s and 30s and you know what I mean? They doing all that, you know? Hey, I can't compete with that. But it's not wise when we compare ourselves one to another neither, because God sees the difference, you see? So it's all about what we choose to do, where we choose to put our energy at. You see, there's one that make himself poor. He ain't making himself poor by being lazy. To make himself poor in this world means that he puts his energy someplace else. You see? And now the Bible tells for us as righteous people, store not our riches here on earth, where thieves break in, where moths can eat up, where rust corrupts. He said, but rather store your riches and your treasures up in heaven. For where man's treasure is, there his heart will be also. And that heart is what makes you rich or what makes you poor. You see? So we get to choose what we're going to chase after. You see? I might not have the riches. My wife used to tease me all the time, because she come from a background of men that, you know, was in the game that always had money. Well, I had been from that background, but that was long gone when I met her, you know. So what she encountered was a man that just didn't have much, coming through a divorce, just getting up off the ground, everything exhausted, you're just trying to get it back. So I was pretty broke, you know what I mean? But as we live our life together, she would poke fun and she'd say, well, you know what? You're the richest broke man that I ever seen. I wouldn't trade you in for all the money in the world. And those things right there was like encouragement. But this is just an example of what we're talking about. You can be the richest poor person among your peers in this world. And they can mock you because of what you don't have. But soon as some calamity hit their house, guess whose phone gonna ring? They know that their money can't help them get through grief. Their money can't help them get through sickness. Their money can't help them when they don't have no comprehension or ain't invested no energy in understanding wisdom. Their money can't help them in that area. So they'll reach for the poor wise man. And there's a story in the Bible that talked about a mighty king that came against a small city to besiege it with all of his men. And there was a poor wise man in the city that rose up and delivered the city from the king's wrath. And nobody in the town remembered the poor wise man. One of my partners had a saying that said, people will listen to a fool with money before they'll listen to a broke man with wisdom. And they're absolutely right, because that's just the nature of the beast. That's just how it's set up. So we get to pick and choose who we want to be. That's right. That's right, Asim, Yemiyahu. It is convenience. That's convenience. And so we don't understand that. Why we being foolish. But once God's wisdom come in, we see it for what it is. So that's why we just blessed to be able to show these simplistic nuggets in the scripture and then be able to show our brothers and sisters these things in your everyday life so it can be a comprehension of it. Let's see. Only by pride come contention, but with the well advised comes wisdom. You see, when people are prideful, they think that they know everything. They think they're above and beyond reproach. You see, and so the Bible tells you, don't rebuke a scorner unless you get a blot. Don't rebuke no wicked man. Unless you get to yourself shame. You see, that's because of pride. You see, by pride come all kind of arguments and all kind of fights and all kind of contention, because you got to know who you can talk to and who you can't. Who's going to be receptive of what you got to say and who's not going to be receptive. You got to be able to draw a line of distinction between that. But with the well-advised is wisdom. And so what we're doing now is, this is what it means to be well advised. We're showing you these things in the scriptures so that you can practice them. When you encounter these situations, that means that you're well advised, because you already know. Well, you know what? I just seen that in the video. I just seen that in the scripture not to do this. So I'm well advised. So I ain't going to be affected by that. Wealth gotten by vanity shall be diminished, but he that gathered by labor shall increase. There's another thing. It's just showing the importance of us not being lazy people, going to work every day. You see, vanity is meaningless. Wealth gotten any other way than what God said. That 6 days thou shalt work. By the sweat of your brow, you shall work for your sustenance. That makes you wise. But when you refuse to work and you got to heap up all kinds of schemes, whether it's to be out here with a sack, whether it's to be, you know, doing some trickery, whether it's doing some trickery on the computer, whether it's some pyramid scheme, some insurance scheme, wealth gotten by vanity, it's going to diminish. But when wealth gotten by labor, see, that's what the Most High going to love that. This is a good one. I used to ponder and try to figure out what this mean, and I couldn't figure out what this mean for a long time. But I'm going to show you. If we got any brothers and sisters on this line right now at this particular time, and you have taken some hits. I mean, whether you've been through a divorce, I mean, whether you've been lost a job, whether you're coming out of a bad relationship, whether you got a hang-up that you're still struggling to get out of, this, I want you to understand this. Verse 12, hope deferred make it the heart sick. But when the desire comes, it is a tree of life. What that means, hope deferred make your heart sick. When you know that you've been up and your life have been good and things have happened to cause you to be in a bad place, and now you got to try to fight your way back and get your way back, it says sometimes hope deferred. That means that sometimes it can seem like, oh, it's going to take me a long time to get back. And that just discourages people. You see, somebody that done lost it all, somebody that done feel like they done went 20 steps backwards, and they feel like, oh, it's going to take me a long time just to get back where I was at. The scripture understands our feelings. So he declares, hope deferred makes your heart sick. Yeah, when you look at the long haul, it may look like a long road. It may look like it's going to take a long time. And you're right. And that's what's discouraging. But here's where the encouragement come in at. It says, but when the desire comes, it's as a tree of life. It ain't going no more. You see, you hang on to the desire and you do what Habakkuk said. Let's see if we can pull that up right quick and put a precept on there. Hope deferred make the heart sick. See if we can put a precept on there, because we want our brothers and sisters to be encouraged while they're chasing after this wisdom. Come on, man. Where is that Habakkuk? Yeah, sometimes it can seem like it's going to take a long time, and sometimes it may take a long time. But you can't stop right there and just get discouraged, because that's what it means for the heart to be sick. It means that you're discouraged. You're discouraged. I remember I was going through that, man. It's going to take me a long time to get over this divorce. And it did. Heart aching, wake up, heart aching every day. So the book of Habakkuk tells you, son of man, I stand on my watch and see what the Most High going to say to me when he speak. He say, write the vision down and make it plain on tablets, that he that readeth it may run with it. For the vision is for an appointed time. And though it may tarry, though it may take you a while, wait for it. For in the end, it shall speak and lie not. And that's what it's talking about. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. When you think of how long it might take you, it may discourage you, but there's another part. It says you keep on working on the vision. You keep on moving toward the goal, one goal at a time, one goal at a time. Because when desire comes, it's going to be a tree of life. In the end, it's going to speak. It's not going to lie. I once did a class where I said, put it on layaway. And you know how it was? Back when we used to do layaway for Christmas and stuff like that, we didn't have the money to go and buy all of the stuff that we want. So we go to Kmart or go to Walmart and we put it in a layaway. It only costs you $20 to put something that costs $500 in the layaway. You put the $20 on it, but you got $480 to pay on it. And once you start looking at that, you're like, oh man, you done paid $60 on the layaway so far, but you still got $400, and you ain't even out of the $400 mark yet. Still got $404. And sometimes that hope deferred will make people's hearts so sick. I even remember times that it'll make my heart heart sick, and I just go, oh, I ain't gonna be able to get it. Just let me get that little money back and pay that little fee. So that's what it's like. That's what it means. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. But for those of us that know, if you just keep it in the layaway, if you just keep paying on it and keep paying on it and keep paying on it, then eventually it's gonna get paid off. Whatever the thing is that you're hoping for, whatever your vision is that you're striving to attain, it's going to happen. So don't get discouraged. Whoso despised the word shall be destroyed, but he that feared the commandment, he shall be rewarded. That's self-explanatory. People that don't want to hear what the word have to say, look at their life a few years from now and watch what happened. And then they're going to turn around and look at your life and watch what happened by what you're doing. See, it's going to be a difference. We can't have the same life when we're doing two completely different things. Every prudent man dealeth with knowledge, but a fool lays open his folly. Now, this is very important, because when you start talking about wisdom, you start talking about dealing with knowledge. It's a prudent man deals with knowledge. He don't deal with foolishness. He dealing with factual things and knowledgeable things that can enhance the life that he living. He ain't got time to be sitting around talking to no dudes about, you know, no. Man, look, you 60 years old. You still talking about women. If you ain't had all the women that you was going to have, you know what I'm saying? You need to just stop. That's foolishness. I don't have no words for nothing like that. Because when you're a prudent person or you're a wise person, you ain't got time for meaningless things. You understand that your life can expire any minute and that your years before you are shorter than the years behind you. So you understand, I don't have no time to waste with foolish stuff. You know what I mean? So if you're going to be wise, you got to cut that rock gut conversation off, sister. You ain't got time to be listening to nobody gossip about what somebody else said. Every time you turn around, somebody want to come and empty a trash can of garbage through your phone. You got to hang up the phone if you're going to be wise. You only want to hear things that's pertaining to factual, truthful things, knowledgeable things that can enhance the life that you or your brothers and sisters are living. And when you're a prudent person, this is what you deal with. But a fool, he lays open all of his foolishness. Every time you see him, that's all they want to talk about. They ain't got nothing to talk about. Poverty and shame shall be to him that refuse instruction. But he that regardeth reproof shall be honored. Poverty and shame is coming to the man that can't receive instruction. Self-explanatory. Self-explanatory. Why? Because wisdom has to know to all things. And by wisdom comes our instruction. And as we apply that instruction, then it makes our life better. But to the man that can't receive no instruction, there's no way for him to get wisdom. And if you ain't got wisdom, you ain't going to do nothing but make bad choices. So poverty and shame is coming to the man that can't receive, that refuse instruction. But he that regards, he that pays attention, he that is open, he that is receptive to correction, he shall be honored. Because if I can show you the area that you just made a bad mistake in and you can receive that and not make the mistake in that area again, that next choice that you make, it will bring you the honor. Shout out to you, Cousin Kim. Shout out to you, Sister Caraway. Shout out to you, Yapa. So, the desire accomplished is sweet to the soul, but it is abomination to fools to depart from evil. You see, when we accomplish the thing that we've been strategically setting goals for, that's sweet to our soul. When you finally pay your last car payment, oh, that's sweet to your soul. When you finally get your house paid, oh, that's sweet to your soul. When you finally get your children graduate, oh, that's sweet to your soul. Because these are areas that we have strategically been setting goals to accomplish and get through. And once you come to the end of it, oh, it's sweet to your soul. It says, but it's an abomination for a fool to depart from evil. See, it's an abomination. It's an abomination for a fool to depart from evil. Let me show you what that means. It is a detestable, downright rot gut, degrading thing to see a fool depart from evil. Well, not to see a fool depart from evil, but that's what it means in the mind of a fool. In the mind of a fool, man, it's an abomination for me to stop doing this evil. That's why you can't help him. Only the fool can help himself when he comes to the understanding that he's a fool and get ready to make the right another set of choices. He had to help himself. You can't help him because it's an abomination in his mind for him to stop doing what he's doing. Man, I ain't never going to stop. Man, I ain't never going to stop. You know what I'm saying? I done heard brothers say that. It's an abomination for him to do anything different. Verse 21, evil pursueth sinners, but to the righteous good shall be repaid. You wonder why so much murder, why so much death, why so much crime? That's because evil is pursuing sinners. Where do you think evil come from? God is the one that sent the evil spirit to torment Saul. When God wanted to cause Ahab to fall in the battle, he said, who shall we send to cause Ahab to fall, that he may fall in battle? Three spirits approached the Most High before his throne. One said, I'll go do this. And another said, I'll go do that. And then another spirit said, I'll go down and persuade him. And the Most High said, how will you go down and persuade him? And he said, I will go down and I will become a lying spirit in the mouth of his prophets, and they will lead him to fall in battle. And the Most High said, go. You see, God is the one that sends the evil that's pursuing the sinners because they won't do right. And the wicked shall be removed from this earth. Evil pursues sinners, because God is the one that sends it after them. But to the righteous, good shall be repaid, because God is the one that's going to do the rewarding for those brothers and sisters that are operating according to his will. A good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of a sinner is laid up for the just. This is where I'm at right now. This is where I'm at in my life. This is where I'm at in my life right now, this moment. This is the thought that I woke up with this morning. And let's just be honest. Springtime is coming. I always had a nice car to ride in over the years. Yeah, I took a good 10-year spiel. Where I really went through the gutter, you know, and I just now get to the point to where I'm climbing out the gutter. And one of the things I was thinking about, man, I want me a nice old school whip, man. I want to, man, I promise to the Most High, if this ain't true, just this morning, I was thinking about that. And then something in my spirit said, man, you know what? You at the time now, man. You ain't got no business. I mean, that's cool, but you still got work that ain't done. You still got to make sure that if you die tomorrow, that you bury. You got your funeral stuff. And you got to make sure that you got in a position where you can get some insurance so you can leave some inheritance for your grandchildren. You got 9 grandchildren, you know? And you need to be able to leave them with something that'll give them a running start. So, you know, hey, man, just be thankful for what you got already. And then once you get this business taken care of, you'll be clear in the clear and free. You know what I mean? You have everything paid for. You know, you your burial stuff is done. You got your funeral stuff done. You got your insurance policies for your grandkids. Now you in the free and clear. You can do whatever you want to do, but you'll be fooled. You'll be a fool to go out there and start high signing. And you know that if tomorrow you die, you know what? They got to collect money to bury you. You'll be a fool. Because a wise man leaves an inheritance to his grandchildren. That's what the books say. And so in my mind, it's like, I can't be content. Me personally, I can't be content until my grandkids, I done did that final thing. But me making sure that I can get buried without somebody else, I don't want to have to come on Facebook and ask brothers and sisters to help me or to help my wife put me in the ground when I'm living and I can be working on that right now. So one of my goals was that when I came into this next summer, my goal was, if the Most High let me live to see it, that the monies that was made working this spring, my burial expenses would be paid for. And my wife's expenses would be paid for. And so if that happens, I've accomplished another goal. And when the last payment is made, it's going to be sweet, because I know that if God called me home, my wife ain't got that stress. My children ain't got that stress. My sisters and brothers don't have that burden. And if I live to see it, the next thing is going to be the inheritance that go to my grandchildren. And if the Most High bless me to see all of that materialize, then he giving me the clear to say, hey, the rest of your life is yours to live. You can go and help who you want to help. But now you can do some things for yourself if you so desire to. That's wisdom. I share these things with you not because my story going to change your life, but because I want you to understand is that I have to live by these principles. You're going to live by them too if you desire to have wisdom. A wise man leaves an inheritance to his children's children. And I don't want to die and be classified as a foolish man, because there ain't no way in this world, when I look at all of the money that I have made in my lifetime, there is no way in this world that my grandchildren shouldn't have something. So these things are in the book. And these things in the book, when you're dealing with wisdom, you're dealing with a completely realigning of focus. So a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of a sinner is laid up for the just. You'd be surprised how many blessings that everybody on this line have received came from the hands of unjust people. You might not have seen the hand that they came from. You might not have seen it. But you can best believe that this book, it means what it says. And you'd be surprised. It's been so much stuff done for me by people that I'm telling you, man, the Most High can just put something on somebody's mind that ain't nowhere in the vicinity of where you at and just make them do something for you. I had somebody come and give me $40 yesterday just for doing something that I love to do. Just for doing something that I love to do. All I've been doing is just playing some music. Playing some music for the older people, because I like to see people happy. And I don't do what I do for money. I do what I do because I love it. I get out there, I take my music to the park, and I just want to play music. I put 5 or 6 hours on a playlist, and I just want to play music, sit in my lawn chair, sip on me a cooler, and let the sun shine on my face, and watch the older people just enjoy themselves, and you know, and just... And you know what? And you know what? In the middle of the day, a brother came. He said, here, man, this ain't much, man, but I just want to give you something because I appreciate it. I said, but I ain't doing that. I'm doing what I love to do. It's a privilege for me to be able to come and dwell in the midst of the older people. Not saying older people, I'm talking about I'm the youngest person there. You see, I'm the youngest person in this area of the park. Everybody else is past 60, you know what I mean? But I just say, you know, this is what I'm talking about when it's talking about that the Most High have things stored up for you. I ain't looking for nothing. I ain't looking for nobody to give me nothing. I told my big brother, I said, man, I just stuck it in my pocket because it didn't matter what it was. But once I got ready to leave and I put it in my pocket, I said, man, that's $40. He gave me $40. So this is what it means. And it happened to all of you. All of you it happened to. And you might not understand where it come from, but it happens. It says, much food is in the tillage of the poor, but there is that is destroyed for want of judgment. Much food is in the tillage of the poor, but there is that is destroyed for want of judgment. Well, that's verse 23, but I'm going to have to ponder that some more. Because these are parables that we're using. And there are still parables in this Bible that the spirit of wisdom have not entered into my mind yet. And this is one of them. I don't fully understand what it's saying. And so I'm not going to try to, you know, I can't put no clarity on it. I can read it again, but it's something that I have to ponder. Like I done had to ponder many things in this book. Much food is in the tillage of the poor, but there is that is destroyed for want of judgment. Verse 24. He that spareth his rod hates his son, but he that loveth him chastise him betimes. That's self-explanatory. The old folks used to say it. Spare the rod, spoil the child. Well, here God says it ain't got nothing to do with spoil. If you spare your rod on your child, that means you hate your child. One of the reasons why our children are out here shooting each other at 13 and 14 years old is because the rod of correction have been spared. There has been nobody there to beat the hell out of them. Like our grandmothers and our mothers and fathers did us. When they said, I'm going to beat the hell out of you, they were literally operating by a principle of wisdom. But there's a form of hatred that have been displayed to this generation of children. When we look at how they're conducting themselves with each other, it shows the level of hatred that the previous generation have shown toward them. They see, they don't want to believe that they hate their children if they don't give them a whooping. If they don't correct them, if they don't allow other people to correct them or other people to chastise them, they don't believe. See, they don't understand what's in the book, and that's why they'll come to their destruction. They don't believe that you hate your child if another grown-up can't correct them or can't chastise them. If you won't chastise them, they don't believe that they hate their children. You think you love your kid. You think you love your kid because you go buy them Jordans and buy them Xboxes and buy them everything they want, and you know what, and they got to be your friend and all that, and you think that's love. That's a form of hatred. If you on this post and you have children, and you know when your children get out of order, you find a way to not deal with them or chastise them or correct them, you try to pacify them, that means you hate your child. And when God kill them, it's going to be your fault. The righteous eat it to satisfying of his soul, but the belly of the wicked shall want. So that's self-explanatory right there. The righteous is going to eat to the satisfying of his soul because he's going to do the necessary things that it takes for him to have the things that he needs to sustain himself. But the wicked is only going to want things because they're not going to be willing to do the things that the Most High is commanding them to do. Shouts out to you, Wallace Rollins III. Shouts out to all of them. So that's going to be our segment on wisdom that was coming out of the 13th chapter of the book of Proverbs. This It's indeed a great day to be alive. It's a day that the Most High have made. We might not get another one tomorrow. Ain't no guarantees even on today. So we gonna find a way to rejoice and be exceedingly glad in it every minute that we can. Peace and blessings to all the brothers and sisters that have been on the thread. Our prayer for you is that the Most High, by His Spirit of power and glory and rulership over this earth, will bless you in every way imaginable, in every area of your life that you need to be blessed, no matter what area it is. We're going to pray that the Most High will enrich you, that He would bless you with double and triple, that you might one day have an abundance overflowing, that you might be able to spill out on your brothers and sisters and become a blessing to them as well. Our prayer is that the Most High would bless you, that He would make His face to shine upon you. Hallelujah.